and its late-night national audience is estimated at 3 to 4 million.
Ali could tell you who hits harder between Foreman and Liston.
King's popularity led to a separate television program on CNN. But that dark, lonely radio studio near Washington, D.C. is the place where he seems most at home.
It's the only way that his life seems to make sense. If he doesn't have this outlet, his life is virtually meaningless.
I've never heard Batman framed quite so well. Thank you, sir.
In radio, we're just sort of letting it happen.
A Batmanologist.
Well, I've never screened a call in my life. I like interviewing. I like that openness. I like the wacko who gets in occasionally.
You're really that kind of a freak.
What do you mean a freak?
That's complimentary. See, if you're going to get...
I like someone who's a little off the mark. Okay, it's kind of like a slice of life.
Now that's a hummer.
This renaissance of radio conversation in the 80s includes another nationally known host. First became famous on late night television in the 70s, Tom Snyder. He still works the late shift, although since October of 1987, he's done it from an ABC radio studio in Los Angeles, coast to coast on 180 stations.
On television, I never know what's on their minds. I don't know what they're thinking when they're watching. Here, I can tell immediately if they're with it or against it.
I gotta say that I'm immensely dissatisfied with the state of our nation right now. We're cutting down the rainforest. Poverty's going up.
I'll tell you something, my friend. There's something going on AM radio. I don't know what it is, but it's doing real good.
We'll be right back after these messages.
In fact, from broadcasting towers around the country, you can hear the voices of an estimated 40 talk hosts syndicated on radio networks and 1,000 others talking night and day at local radio stations.
Do you feel power from this show?
Yes.
You think this show is a powerful media approach for you?
More powerful than you could possibly imagine, because powerful people in this country hear the least powerful in this country and they respond.
You know, as anyone has a voice and once getting...
Because they preside over national audiences, linking listeners as if they were all meeting in the same backyard, we sat in with King on the East Coast and Snyder on the West Coast to see how the process works. In the first hours, live guests, Smokey Robinson on this night, helped draw in the listeners.
Rap on, brother!
But the nightly mix inevitably boils down to dialogue between the hosts and the callers. And so, with the help of the show's producers, we also placed camera crews with the people who complete the connection.
Hello, Tom.
Hi, Mary Lou, you're on.
And
what we got was a picture of a late-night subculture that is talk radio's heart and soul.
You've had some good shows this last week, and I've had more fun listening to them.
Mary Lou Hathaway, who's a regular caller to Tom Snyder, usually dials in from a phone booth in Yucca Valley, California. She has no home phone.
You're out in the country here tonight, aren't you, Mary Lou? Yeah. You're outside to the phone.
No phone tonight, but I... He is filling a void that has been in my life the last few months. I'm in the middle of a divorce. A lot of times I'm lonely in the evening. I don't have that much money to go out and go out and do what every single people do. He's like a big brother and a friend at a time in my life when I need that.
I'm lucky in that I can connect with situations. I can connect with people's predicaments because I've heard about them before. It's just a more relaxed and a far more intimate way of broadcasting. There's something about people who stay up late at night that is different from people who get up earlier in the morning. They're loyal to a fault. They're loyal to me here as Larry's are to him.
Worcester, Massachusetts. Hello.
Hi, Larry.
Hi.
And once in a while, you hear about this airplane going down, and I think, they're getting too old.
While some people listen for the companionship, others are in it for the debate and the education.
It's, to me, working plus, coming here, it's like a night school, because I learn a lot.
At the Treat Me Donuts Bakery in Worcester, Massachusetts, a Lebanese immigrant named Shade Shade is making donuts for the next morning's customers. And on this night, mulling over the connections between international politics and airplane maintenance.
If you compare the States with the Aeroflot, the Soviet airlines.
If Aeroflot had an accident,
you'd hear about it. They report that now.
Yeah, right, but I mean, they don't have it as much.
It's a topic that could go down like a lead balloon in the interest of a few million other listeners. But that's where King's skill comes in, turning the conversation another direction and adding a twist of humor.
What are you doing right now?
I'm making the donuts.
You're a donut baker.
Right.
Basically, you don't like donuts, do you, sir?
Not really.
In fact, you're the kind of
guy that likes Aeroflot airliners,
And you hate donuts.
No.
In fact, sir,
I think you're a KGB agent. Yeah, come on.
You find me out, Larry. Leave it between you and me.
Okay, thank you. There he goes.
Because all this happens late at night, rating surveys are limited, and there is no standard profile of who the average listener is.
It's why are you up night tonight? We thank you.
But Larry King does his own informal survey once a year, and it turns up an assortment of fiercely loyal fans. 55-year-old Shirley Duffy even takes tapes of the King show on vacation with her when she leaves the country.
Winchester,
Massachusetts, why are you up?
I'm up specifically to listen to you, as I do every night.
It's very nice to talk to you. I'm a longtime admirer.
Would you say
you're addicted?
I'm afraid so.
My guess used to be that the person calling was a good bet to be alone. Lately, I hear a lot of people with people in the background. Or, keep quiet, Martha, I'm on the phone.
My husband goes to sleep early.
He doesn't say that. Damn, Larry King, shut him off.
You're there.
He's glad.
The thing I'm most surprised at on my show is the amount of young callers and the amount of college students who listen.
Larry, I've always been fascinated how you know which city.
New York City, hello.
Troquet, Minnesota.
Cocoa, Florida, hello.
I just thought you did it off the top of your head, or you added some kind of a Ouija microphone.
Roanoke, hello.
There are producers who answer the phones first and take down basic information.
Selma, turn down your radio and hang on, please.
It's you and T.S. all alone on the telephone.
For instance, on Tom Snyder's show, a producer takes the name and location of each caller and then types them onto a computer screen, first come, first served, that Snyder can read in the studio.
Here's Chip in Washington, D.C. Hi, Chip, you're on.
Many of the names are familiar. Snyder knows that if a call comes in from Washington, D.C. actor Chip Brianza, it may mean a little craziness.
Can you hear that now, Tom? Yes, it's popping. We got popcorn. We're getting a little bit of smoke here. That's all right.
Sometimes it'll be too serious, and I'll call to say something funny, I hope.
If you hear someone like Brianza fairly regularly, it's not because he knows any secrets about how to get on a talk show.
Delicious, Tom. You see
that? It's because, surprisingly, only about 2% of the talk radio listeners ever actually call in. And among that subculture of a subculture, Brianza says there are unwritten rules of behavior.
You get the feeling that people are really saying what they feel and what they think and what they believe. A kind of respect for other people's ideas. But more importantly than that, there's a kind of code of conduct.
What?
You don't sound Christian-like.
When our children are threatened by you Jews, York with that mayor, that Jewish mayor, I get extremely mad.
What happens when the code of conduct is broken?
What is the point of this?
There's a tape delay of a few seconds, so profanity can be bleeped before it hits the air. But short of that, knowing how to keep control of the spontaneity is how the hosts earn their money.
I hit the call, it says, Cincinnati. And the guy says, this is God. And I want to talk to America through your show. And I said, what are you doing in Cincinnati? I mean, if you said Vegas, okay. You know, but Cincinnati.
Well, one of the qualities that people seem to like about those talk shows late at night is that they do draw an imaginary picture of other places and other people. And from listening, Jim Blackwell, who drives a cab in New York City, can concoct descriptions of a land he doesn't see and a light that's shining somewhere else.
It's kind of a beacon in the night. The callers come from all different backgrounds, all different places, and yet there's a kind of closeness in that everybody is listening to the same show in the middle of the night.
Let him finish, Opera.
Have $1.80.
She'll give it to you right away and let him finish the song. We're on the air. Go ahead.
When New York had a lot of children that didn't know what to do with, they put them on the train and sent them out here west.
Did they know that you were coming on the train?
Yes.
Oh, that's terrific.
I will tell you.
I'm not here to save the world. I'm here to inform and entertain as many people as want to click on the old radio at night and turn off the television.
Okay, good night, Tom.
Maybe I've laughed a little or maybe felt like crying. So I'm coming away with maybe learning something, too.
Tomorrow night, Tom, we're going to make something very simple, very quick, very neat, very easy. Coffee.
Okay.
All you need is a pot, some water.
I'm Tom Snyder, and you've been on the radio show now in Los Angeles, California. Sweet dreams and sleep tight, America. Good night, everybody.
has been a very fragile and delicate relationship, and it ends at a time when television is changing. I look back to the good old days when there were quiet hours spent here with David Letterman, who made his first appearance on network television on this show, and who'll begin in this time period on February 1st of next year. We came on the air very quietly back in October of 1973, and I want us to go off the very same way. I thank you for the good times and for the ride, and I'll be right around the corner. George, a slow fade to black. Thank you all for watching, and good night, everybody.
Thanks for staying up later. I'm Bob Costas. This is Tom Snyder. And you're telling me you don't feel comfortable with the roles reversed.
It's not easy to sit in this chair and think that you're going to ask me questions. I usually ask questions, and tonight I'm going to be asked questions. And yeah, I get a little nervous about that.
Not only is that role reversed, but this used to be your time slot. Time slot that you carved out a piece of TV history.
Well, I mean, a lot of us did that, you know. But okay, I carved it out. And what your viewers might have a little bit of interest in is that in this studio, which is number 5 in Burbank, I walked in here in August of 1970 for the first time and did the news on the local NBC station here. So there's a lot going on in this head right now in this particular room. But yeah, it's a nice little time period you've got here, I'll tell you.
3 years later, the Tomorrow Show comes on the air, then an hour show, eventually went to 90 minutes, as I recall. And you're on the air from 73 through 81. I was a faithful viewer, and I recall the last show, Nancy Friday gave you a big wet kiss. Chevy Chase was on, putting the knock on the NBC executives for being so dumb as to yank your show off the air. And then you had a memorable close. As the cigarette smoke swirled around your head, you said to George Paul, who now is the director of the Today Show, that'll wrap it up. Folks, thanks for the ride. I'll be right around the corner. George, give us a slow fade to black.
Yep.
Which was kind of a haunting way to end. But were you really right around the corner? I think people expected to see you on network television fairly soon.
No, I meant that you may not see me, but I'll be right around the corner. We did a lot of stuff back then that people still remember and still talk about. I mean, a lot of it was so-so, but a lot of it was pretty good television, too. We took this country through a tough time, Bob. We took them through Watergate, okay? We had on every single Watergate figure except for Richard Nixon. We had them all in this time period, including the special prosecutor, Leon Jaworski. So when I said goodbye, I really felt that an era or a time in television was changing, when television was becoming more format-driven as opposed to talent-driven or star-driven, when the technology of talk, which we're doing here, was taking over just the business of talk, whirling boxes, flashing lights, print on the screen to tell people what was coming up next. We didn't do any of that. And as it was coming in, I became more and more uncomfortable with it. And so what I was trying to say was, you know, it's all changing. And thanks for staying with us. And even if you don't see me, I know you're going to remember some of this, so I'll be right around the corner. At least that's what I meant.
Memorable shows. You had Manson on.
Manson was really, it's a memorable show, but it was, again, it's almost a stunt, all right? Because Manson's an obvious thing. Manson's a ratings grabber. I mean, Geraldo went after Manson because Manson guarantees a number. A generation of American kids grew up with Helter Skelter on television and in the library, so Manson is kind of a stunt, okay? A guy came to us, I can't tell you his name, Bob, because I don't recall, but he knew Manson. And he was writing a book on Manson, and he needed some advance cash to get this thing going. So he went to the producers, and he said, in return for, I forget the number, $10,000, $12,000, whatever it was, I can deliver you, Charles Manson, in the jailhouse up north in California. The producer said, hey, fantastic. So we went to do Manson. Now, absolutely no information came out of Manson in terms of what he said. But in terms of the fact that the guy was an absolute nutcase.
Just to look at his face.
Yeah, okay, with the swastika and the, a nutcase, all right? People say, what is it with Manson? Manson is a nutcase. That was all that was learned from that interview. But it got a big number, I'll tell you. It got a very large rating. Yeah. Did you kill Shay?
Hell no.
Did you cut Hinman's ear off?
Hell yes.
How'd that feel when you cut his ear off?
I felt bad.
Truth is
about
fun
it.
Though. Isn't the truth fun now when
yeah,
you okay,
sure,
okay.
Sure.
You cut his ear off.
When
what did it feel
truth
like?
Fun? My goodness.
What did it feel like when you cut his ear off? Huh? Tell me about it. Come on.
What did it feel like?
Yeah.
Well, I had done what he said for about 20 years. I'd done everything he told me to do. And I got to thinking, now, why don't this guy do something I tell him to do? And he said, no. I said, well, how comes I'm always doing what you tell me to do, but then you never do what I say do? And he said, well, blah, blah, blah. So I said, now you do what I say. And he said, no. I said, you do exactly what I say. And he said, no. I'm telling you. I'm not asking you. I'm telling you. You do exactly what I say.
I remember when Lennon came on, and I was a little disappointed because he was facing deportation then, and he comes on with his lawyer,
right,
which was so opposite of the image of the freewheeling guy that we all wanted to see.
If John Lennon had never been shot, and I wish, incidentally, that that were the case, the Lennon interview would have long since lapsed into obscurity. But because he was shot in New York and died, that little piece of videotape, which in essence was his appeal to America to be allowed, you say correctly, his deportation attorney was with him, it was his appeal to America to please let me stay in this country because I'm going to be sent back to Great Britain and I don't want to go. I'm an American. So it turned out it's now a cult favorite. It's sold in video stores and people say, wow, John Lennon. But in my view, it was never a great interview.
Jerry Lewis. That was a memorable one.
Jerry Lewis, the only 90-minute Saturday show in our history, because a program called Saturday Night Live was not ready for the air. So they called our office and they said, could you do something to fill the time? So we booked Jerry Lewis for an hour and 15 minutes. And then for 15 minutes, we presented Gilda and Lorraine and Jane and Bill and Chevy and Garrett and John, the not ready for prime time players. You all know their last names. With a young producer named Lorne Michaels, and off to the side, a very young program executive named Dick Ebersol, who was recently named president of sports for this network.
Now czar of the universe.
And is the executive producer of this program. And Dick said, why don't we put these people on to introduce them to America? I said, fine. They came in, Bob. They were terrified because they had no idea what to do. I'm not stealing, but they didn't have a script with things to read. And so for them, coming out of set pieces with Second City or wherever, it was tough for them to ad lib. Only Chevy Chase was a hit.
Extremely glib.
And he fell down. And he fell down. And I thought to myself, hey, these people are never going to make it. Another one I called perfectly, right?
Did you get self-conscious when people started imitating you? When Aykroyd and then others imitated you, did it make you rein in your own style at all?
Well, I watched Aykroyd, and I said, you know, I don't do that. I don't go, haw, haw. I mean, he did that thing, you know. And it was flattering when he did it, you know. You'd see him on Saturday Night Live, imitating myself and my mother with Jane Curtin. It's a little flattering. But, yeah, I pulled back a little bit. Sure, I did.
Later in L.A., we'll be right back.
Back with Tom Snyder. What happened when Hitchcock came on the show? Anything worthwhile?
Oh, I'll tell you, Hitchcock, you know, Hitchcock was a legend. So they had, you think that these are large chairs. We got two thrones for Hitchcock. Baronial thrones, and put them 8 feet off the ground.
Yeah.
And when he walked into the studio, my friend, it stopped. It just, you know, when Hitchcock, our director was a young kid, Joel Tater, and the director walked in, a man who's been compared with Truffaut. I mean, it just stopped. He wasn't that easy a man to interview. The only thing that I remember is I asked him, I said, you know, you've scared everybody in the world. What scares you? And he said, a policeman. And I said, why? He said, because a policeman is the only man in our life that can say, you, come with me, and you have to go. He was terrified of police. I don't remember much else about it.
What then, maybe this answer is the same now, what scares you? When you were out there on the Tomorrow Show, were you afraid that some part of yourself that you weren't, that you didn't feel good about or that you were ashamed of would be seen somehow, it would come through?
No, not really. The only thing that I'm afraid of in a broadcast studio, and I can't tell you why, is a studio audience. The last time I was in this building, I was down the hall, as you've been, with Jay Leno on The Tonight Show with 500 people. And you remember the scene in broadcast news where the guy sweats until he's going to... Yeah. I mean, when I got out of there, I was drenched. I mean, I'm very comfortable here. This is like home
When you anchored the news in various markets, New York
problem,
and L.A.,
no
nothing.
No problem. No problem.
If the teleprompter went down, you no felt
problem.
As if you were taking
kept
a walk
going.
In the park.
Yeah, no problem. But boy, put me in a room where there's a studio audience, and I start thinking they're all here, and they want to win a car, and I don't have one for them. I get scared, you know, because they go, it's a new car, but I don't have any new cars, you know.
Usually a Chevy Nova, as I recall.
Yeah. But that's the only thing that I've ever been frightened of is studio audience for some reason.
Are you displeased by what you see in talk television now?
You see, if I say yes, then they say, well, he's sour grapes, because he's not doing talk television right now.
There's a lot of talk on TV that's wrestling. It's performance television. And without mentioning names, I mean, they all know who I mean. There are people who are very quiet and very meek in a room, and the minute they get before the cameras, stuff starts flying around. So it's performance or talk wrestling, and I'm not comfortable with that. I'm not uncomfortable with some of the topics that are on the afternoon shows, Donahue and Oprah and Sally Jesse Raphael. But the way sometimes in which those topics are presented, racial issues in front of a studio audience that's been whipped to a frenzy when chairs start flying back and forth, Phil Donahue discussing transvestites and coming out in a red dress. I mean, there's a way to do guys who dress up.
And you know, folks, I would have liked to have seen you in that garb, all 6'4" of you.
Folks would have what?
They would have liked to have seen you in that garb.
I was good in the black one, but I...
More figure flattering, Tom.
But we just wouldn't do stuff like that.
But when you talk about TV then being more star-driven, certainly you were a television star. As people see you even in the... don't deny it. As people see you in the first 5 minutes here, it is impossible for them not to think of Dan Aykroyd imitating you, not to think of that persona, the gestures, the face that came right through the screen. You weren't just a guy who was ushering interesting people into their living rooms. You were an interesting guy yourself.
You use the word star. I've always liked the word communicator. For whatever the reason, there are two great sins, false pride and false modesty, and I try to have neither. I was able, for whatever the reason, to bring somebody on a television program and let the viewer see a side of that person that they might not ordinarily have seen. Not because I ask such great questions, but because I think, as you do here, you operate in the quiet of a television studio. I would not be nearly as effective with you right now if you had 500 people out here laughing at your laugh lines or laughing at some piece of business going on offstage. But by the very nature of my beast and your beast, we're able to get great moments on these programs because this is it. I mean, you and me are it right now. There's nothing else going on that screen, and it gives the audience a chance to really understand what we're saying and see what we're saying, and in a lot of cases, feel what we're saying. There's not a lot of feeling on television anymore, and you can get feeling in studios like this that are quiet.
Isn't it a crime that you're not on TV? For all the flaws that may have been cited, and you had your critics, as everybody does, and maybe you had more than your share because of your flamboyant personality, but even stipulating that, isn't it a crime that you're not on television?
I don't think so. Bob, if I chose to be on television, I could be on television. And I don't say that, again, with false pride or false modesty. But the things that I've been given a chance to do on television aren't things that I feel suit me best and don't give me a chance to do what I'm most comfortable doing. And that's basically what we're doing right here. I'm not good at big television. I'm not good at event television. I'm not good at spectacle television. I'm good at moment television. A lot of times on the old shows, we would take an hour to get to one moment. Mm-hmm. And a lot of times that moment was well worth getting to. I'll never forget the night. We had Shelley Berman on air. And Shelley was traveling around doing a comic act around the country. And we got to a break, and I said, by the way, I said, you know, your son, Josh, I believe his name was, died at the age of 13. I said, would you mind if I referred to that? He said, no, he said, that'd be great. He said, because my wife and I are active with other parents of kids who are terminally ill and critically ill. And he said, I would love to talk about that and maybe offer some hope for other parents whose kids are in tough shape. I said, fine. So the break was all over, and I framed a question, and he started talking about it. He said, yeah, he said, Josh died, and he was 14, and it was tough for my wife and tough for me. He said, and we tried to help parents whose kids were in similar circumstances. And he stopped, and I could just see the whole thing, you know, going this way. He says, the night Josh died, he says, I was on a stage in Cleveland, Ohio. And he said, I was never funnier. And the room stopped. I mean, just stopped. Now I teared up, and he teared up, and we muddled through as best we could. Mm-hmm. Well, out of an hour, that was the only thing that was really compelling. But God, what a moment in television to see a man, you know, make himself naked before all of us talking about the death of his son. So that's the kind of stuff that I enjoy doing.
Generally speaking, as I recall it, you weren't that comfortable and didn't have that great an affinity with rock and roll people, although you had the big ones on the show.
No, towards the end it became, by the way, you do a radio show called Bob Costas Coast to Coast, is that right?
Right.
Get rid of Coast to Coast, pal. It doesn't work. It doesn't work.
Yeah, tomorrow Coast to Coast.
No, just Bob Costas is okay.
On the other hand, Rona Barrett is not on the show.
True, and probably won't be.
Every chance she won't be.
No, I mean on Bob Costas.
Right.
Oh, okay. Speak for yourself.
She was on this show, though.
I know she was.
Yeah. Once.
Mm-hmm. No, you see, I don't. You can't do that. I won't comment on that. I haven't from the time it happened, and it will go. It's not really worth talking about. It's a singularly unimportant event in the history of television. Miss Barrett and myself on the Tomorrow Show. It counts for zippo in the history of television.
But no comment is a comment in and of itself.
Of course it is. I mean, you know, she's been everywhere with it. She's gotten a lot of mileage from it. But I don't need that kind of mileage. Anyway, I want to get back here to the rock and roll people. Towards the end, when we expanded to 90 minutes, don't ever expand to 90 minutes. 90 minutes, death.
We're trying to fill 30 as best we can.
No, we don't.
we're looking to crawl before we walk and run here, Tom.
We don't fill. We balance out the program so that the commercials are this far apart. Okay. Rock and roll people play great music, but it was always my view that by the time it got to the home viewer. In those days, it's on a speaker like this, which has absolutely no range, no highs, no lows, just flat, loud noise coming out of a small speaker. I didn't feel that the rock and roll audience, who by this time was sophisticated enough to listen on FM stereo, would want to listen to it on television.
But you must have been underestimating your own appeal or the appeal of your show, because this is pre-MTV. It's pre-cable television, and other than the curiosity pop on the Ed Sullivan Show or maybe a little thing on American Bandstand, these guys had no mainstream access. You gave it to them.
True.
People couldn't see the Grateful Dead or Elton John even that often.
Well, now you're talking about the great ones. I'm talking about the night that What's-Her-Face, Wendy O. Williams, and the Plasmatics came in and blew up a car for sake in the middle of NBC in New York. You know, in Studio 3K, they come in there with a Pinto or a Mustang, and they blow this sucker up in the middle of the John Chancellor news. Now the news guy comes down, he says, "What's going on down here?" I said, "Well, we're just blowing up a car. I mean, nothing unusual about that, is there?" I mean, and that made me nuts. You know, the night they blew up the car.
Did Chancellor then wind up going out to dinner with Wendy O. Williams?
He wasn't Chancellor then. He was Chancellor. That was pre the switch, okay? Just a joke, John, a dumb, stupid joke. But, hey, what are they going to do, take the Tomorrow Show off the air?
Go figure, Tom.
Yeah, exactly. What are they going to do, kill it? But, I mean, the night they blew up the car, that was the night when there was smoke and debris all over Studio 3A in New York, when I stepped to the back and I said to myself, "Hey, look what they've done to my song." That was the night I knew, hey, this sucker's over. When we start blowing up cars, we're in trouble.
And that was toward the end, huh?
It was very close to the fat lady, yeah.
In fact, you had a fat lady, a fat opera singer on the last show.
Yeah, and you know, I felt bad about that. You know, there's an old...
Because the opera ain't over. You go ahead.
It's an old saying in showbiz that it's never over till the fat lady sings. And I mean, it's tough to bring a lady into a show and say to her, "Hey, folks, here's a fat lady." I mean, she has an ego and she has pride and kids and a husband and a love life, right? So I said the fat lady's going to sing, and I was embarrassed to say it, but she sang L'Amour. Perfect, right?
How often were you embarrassed? Because that was a rap on you. Here's a guy whose strength can become his weakness. His strength is the compelling personality. He is a communicator. People have a feeling about him.
Oh,
but the rap is too flamboyant, likely to do almost anything at any time that can trivialize it.
Listen to this. I'm flamboyant, right? Did I walk off the NBC Nightly News at the end of a tennis match and leave my network in black for 6.5 minutes? Did I stiff a cab driver in San Francisco, California, and have him drive me all over the streets?
Chicago.
Did I engage the Vice President of the United States in mortal combat on live television? I didn't do any of those things.
Dan Rather hasn't been criticized.
And they call me flamboyant? They call me flamboyant? Hey, I was a pussycat compared to what goes on now. Phil Donahue comes out in a red dress. Geraldo gets his nose broken on television. Sally Jesse Raphael walks with the hookers in the dreck of Manhattan's Tenderloin District. And I was flamboyant? Hey, Bob,
and
somebody
are,
better define flamboyant, because they...
And you are to all of them, as Magellan was to those who follow. Into uncharted waters you went.
Yeah, into uncharted waters, but never to the red light district in a dress, I'll tell you.
So you watched through the last commercial to hear me say, Tom Snyder will be back with us tomorrow night. Hope you will be too. See you later. Back for the nightcap of this doubleheader with Tom Snyder tonight.
Only seven innings tonight,
on
folks.
Later. That's
American
right.
Association
remember
ball.
That? The minor leagues, only seven innings in the second game of a doubleheader. We go the full 30 minutes for this one. We were talking about some of the big-name guests last night, but I know you also enjoyed the quirky shows, shows where a goldfish got shot up in the air.
Yeah, we shot goldfish through the air, and one night we had a guy on the Amazing Randy, not to be confused with the Amazing Randy that we all tend to think of, okay? The you know, the guy who's the parapsychologist,
right,
that investigates fraud. This guy came on, and he had a female assistant, and he's in a safe, and he's going to do one of these amazing escapes, okay? So naturally, we go to the clock counting down. There's only 30 seconds of air, ladies and gentlemen, and if the MAF Randy doesn't get out in time, he'll perish inside this safe, which is hermetically sealed, and all of a sudden the door flies open, and the only problem is you see a little inside handle flopping up and down, you know.
What a low-rent act. Not only could this guy not do tricks, he cops somebody else's name.
Yeah, exactly, and the little handle going up and down. Then there was the night with the great young Blackstone, Harry Blackstone Jr.,
yeah,
where the lady from box A wearing the red suit will be transposed with the lady from box B wearing the blue suit, that without you ever seeing this happen before your eyes, they will switch places. So he says, you know, presto change-o magico, and all you can hear is, we're not ready yet, we're not ready yet, we're not. And of course, I'm there saying, homina, homina, homina. Then there was the other night where we had a lady come on who was going to make an electric train go around the track by using her brain cells, right? Huh?
Mm-hmm.
You can see it coming, can't you? Right? And out of the corner of my eye, I see the guy's hand going to the transformer to turn the current out, okay? And I just said to the mic, I said, take two. And the director took two, and you saw the guy turning the transformer and blew the whole act.
You know, you performed a great service, I think, for the American public when you laid it out there, how to give a Hollywood party. Remember that one?
Terrible show. Bob, truly an awful show. We had a restaurant, we had a flower shop, we had cakes and catering. And they had this record. But you have to know that we had just come back from a road trip. We'd come back from Hawaii and Hong Kong and Vietnam, 10 shows and 9 days on the road. We were all exhausted. But we, you know how you have to do one more to fill out the week?
Sure.
We had to do this one more. So Joel Tater, the producer, says, look, he says, this is a quick one. It's how to give a Hollywood party. He says, you'll wear a tuxedo. You'll have a parrot on your shoulder. I said, what do you mean? He says, no, trust me, you'll like this. So they come in and the bird's here, okay? And every segment starts out, da, 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 da. The worst arrangement of her. It's not funny now, but if you had the tape, and I know you don't, it's laugh time, because the show was terrible. It was just not a very good show.
Could you sleep well nights after doing a show that you knew was
I'll tell
coming?
You what's. Yeah, and you can too, can't you?
No.
Really?
Uh-uh.
Let me put your mind at ease and tell you why. You come back four nights a week, Monday through Thursday. What if you came on Tuesday night and you did a bomb? And you've got to wait till next Tuesday before you get a chance to come on and redeem yourself.
Mm-hmm.
That's tough.
It's the difference between baseball and football.
Yeah, exactly. There you go. You play a dumb baseball game on Monday, you get blown out 12-2, you win 5-3 the next night. Football, you got 7 days to wait, whereas in our business, if you do it every night as you do and as I did, hey, we're coming back tomorrow night. We don't have time to worry about last night.
And I think there was something, we made this point last night, something about your show and something about you which was fascinating to the viewer.
What do you mean even last night? What do you mean last night? We just did it 20 minutes ago.
Well, but the folks saw it last
okay.
night. And oddly enough, we came back in the same clothes the second night. But the viewer found something fascinating about you and about the possibilities. Even if those possibilities never came through, there was always mm-hmm. a chance something outrageous might happen.
Well, we never stopped tape, just as you don't hear. When you start, I mean, let's face it, we didn't do the thing from 1 to 2 o'clock in the morning. We did it from 5 to 6 or 6 to 7 in the afternoon. But we never stopped tape. We never fixed it. It was live television on videotape. And there were a lot of nights, especially in New York, where we did the show live. So it wasn't as if we were hiding anything from the viewer. What we did is what they saw. There were no outtakes from the 8.5 years.
You know, it was one, if I can commiserate with you,
go ahead.
It really bothered me, and it bothers me still. We had Stephen Wright on the show. I'm a huge fan of this guy's work. I love this guy.
Yeah.
But with no audience.
Yeah.
And with a conversation instead of doing his stand-up act, all that deadpan stuff, it was like a tree falling in an empty forest.
It died, yes.
And I didn't know what to do. I felt a little bit uncomfortable, and I got letters from people who thought that I was being unkind to him, and I love the guy. I'd walk 100 miles to see him in concert.
Sure.
But it was a bomb sitting right here.
Yeah.
Still feel bad about it.
You shouldn't. Mine was Joey Bishop, who's, an old-line comedian, who came in one night and did an hour of shtick, in an empty studio. Now, I'll laugh at maybe 50% of it, but the other 50% to me wasn't funny. And Joey thought he bombed. He didn't bomb. He just did a comedy routine in front of an empty studio instead of telling stories about what he did. See, a lot of people don't realize that this is not a stand-up performance here. This is storytelling. This is relating and sharing bits and pieces of your life with Bob and his audience.
I had forgotten until one of our producers reminded me that you did a show on nudism long before Geraldo grabbed headlines with it.
Yeah, we went up to a thing called the Elysium Institute, north and west of Los Angeles. It was one of these places where, and this is back in the 70s, all right? This is 19, 20 years ago. And at the time they said, well, this isn't really a nudist colony. This is a self-help realization organization where you come to find your real self. And of course, to find your real self, you parade around without your clothes on, okay? So naturally, we went up there and presented this to America as a self-help program, when in fact it was a visit to a nudist colony. And we had the, that's we black boxed, you know?
Yeah.
That's, and with women, here, just black boxed. Did I take the mic off?
No, no, it's fine.
So, I mean, there was no great big secret. We just black boxed it, and...
You were kind of uncomfortable with shows like that.
Yeah, I didn't like it because it was, and I'm not trying to be funny here. I'm very bad when I try to be funny. It was a naked grab for ratings. I'm never comfortable when we do something transparent to get a big number.
Were you uncomfortable, though, not so much with a grab for ratings, but with sex topics generally?
I was uncomfortable if we did them in a tacky way. There's a way to do sexuality, human sexuality, on television without being locker room and without being tacky about it. And some of the shows that we did, I was very pleased doing. You know, we did shows on impotence, you know, in a time when penile implants were first being talked about, and we did it straightforward and very matter-of-fact without a lot of hype and without graphics, but just talking about the men and the women they love who share this problem. And I wasn't uncomfortable with that in any way.
I thought, thank God I'm going to be doing the Tomorrow Show, because this is important. If you're going to understand male sexuality, women, men have to understand the significance and importance of oral sex for men. And I was able, wonderfully, to discuss it on your show that night when I was a guest.
Mm-hmm.
Now that I'm part of the family, of course, it's different. And it's like, you know how it always is in the family.
I'll tell you what, I will, yeah. I will try and find a place where we can have that discussion, okay? And in the meantime, let's both stay in shape.
Listen, Tom, honey, you say you're ready for a woman to take the initiative?
Yes, but Nancy, not with hundreds of people watching.
Come on, honey, for old time's sake,
okay, sweetheart.
Give us a kiss.
Easy, wait, wait.
Did you ask Liberace when you had him on about his being a homosexual, or was that just off limits and you figured everybody knew and he's too nice a man and leave it alone?
I couldn't do it. I could not ask him that question. Again, the time that he was on the show, he did it at 2 or 3 o'clock in the morning in Las Vegas after doing his show at the Hilton Hotel. And I couldn't ask him. There's a lot of times, there's a lot of questions that I haven't been able to ask. There was a night that Coretta Scott King was on the air on a two-way, which are two-ways are tough to do, because if you or I were a screen on the wall, we wouldn't have the rapport that we have for these fleeting moments, because we are looking into each other's eyes and there is a bond, an understanding mm-hmm. between us. So I was talking with Coretta Scott King after all this came out in the press about J. Edgar Hoover and the wiretaps on Martin Luther King and his supposed womanizing, you know, with others. So I framed a question, and Mrs. Scott King is up here on the screen, and I'm looking up there, and I say, you know, Mrs. King, with all respect, I said, I have to ask this. You've read the accounts in the press about your husband and what the FBI purports that he did. What comment do you have on this? She said, well, she said, Mr. Snyder, she said, no matter what I read or what I hear, my husband loved me, and he loved me alone. And she stopped. Now, I know exactly what that means, that no matter what he did, she was confident that he loved her and her alone. So I stopped right there, because I couldn't say, well, does that mean... I couldn't ask it. I felt that's enough information from her on that. I just took out my chin and grin and said...
Later in L.A.
This is NBC Sunday Night News, December 14th, with Tom Snyder reporting from the NBC News Center in New York.
Good evening. At Bijl in the Netherlands, six gun-bearing guerrillas surrendered today after holding 23 people hostage on board a passenger train there since the 2nd of December.
Continuing with Tom Snyder, there was a time...
It's a telephone.
decade or so ago when people speculated, quite honestly,
yep.
Is this guy going to replace Johnny Carson? Or is he going to replace John Chancellor? You were in the middle there.
Yeah, I was. You see, my whole discipline, as I said to you last night here, this studio, I started doing news for NBC in this room in 1970. On the night that Chet Huntley said goodbye and left the Huntley-Brinkley Report, you know, we started doing the news for Channel 4 here. And we did very well here. There was a young sports announcer named Bryant Gumbel. We used to work in this studio with us. And there was a young fellow who anchored the 11 o'clock news named Tom Brokaw, who worked in this studio. And all of us went on to New York in different capacities, and I wound up with a late-night show called Tomorrow, which was entertainment, it was quasi-journalism, it was sometimes informative. But it wasn't, in the strict sense, news or journalism. And that was a problem for a lot of people who were in charge of the news department. They thought that that somehow I was a fish and they were fowl, or vice versa. And I can understand that. But I used to say to them, I say, you have to keep in mind that the people who watch what all of us do, whether your name is Snyder or Costas or Brokaw or Gumbel, they either like us or dislike us depending upon what we do, not upon what hat we wear, whether we're born in the city room of the New York Times, or whether we're born in the middle of a vaudeville act in a trunk. And I said, you know, you people are hung up on the fact that I am not a real journalist. And I said, I understand that. I said, but I really think you ought to take a step back and look at how I'm perceived by audiences and what I do. And as the further I went along, I realized that there was a basic problem. I worked in local news for NBC at Channel 4 in New York and in Los Angeles. And my job was to get a big rating bump. The job of the anchorman in television news, and you know this, and the viewers are now onto this as well, although they weren't back in the 70s, is to get a big rating. The job of the journalist is to cover the news, and therein is a quandary. If you are out to get a big rating, if that's your job, can you properly cover the news? My answer is yes, except the news that I got to cover was different.
But if you had desired to do the network news, there might have been a valid distinction, because you said earlier that people perceive you whether they like you or not, and
sure,
that's really what matters.
Sure.
But isn't it entirely possible that somebody could be watching this show and say, I like Bob Costas, the sportscaster. I don't like him as well here. Maybe some people like me in both roles,
yeah,
but some prefer me in one over the other. And so someone could have said, Tom Snyder, the flamboyance works in a local news situation, the jocular approach works, it's great for the Tomorrow Show, but I can't see this guy where Rather and Tom Brokaw are now.
That's fine, except that determination will be made not by the management of NBC Sports and not by the management of the NBC Entertainment Division, but by the people who are watching that camera right there. I got terrific ratings on the news in Los Angeles and New York, and I got very good ratings on the Tomorrow Show at 1 o'clock in the morning. So the decision, it seems to me, was made by the viewers. Hey, we understand what a Tom Snyder is. We know what he is. But the perception was, you know, words like arrogant and controversial popped up in the press. There was a cartoon in the New Yorker magazine where the people come home from dinner and the babysitter says, Johnny was very good and Tom Snyder was very abrasive tonight, you know. And that kind of thing gets around, and it's a little baggage that I brought with me. But I really feel that, you know, there was a perception that my job was to get big ratings, and they felt that if I did the network thing that I would somehow embarrass them. And I understand that, and believe me, I have no regrets, no sour grapes, no animosity, no bitter, no nothing.
In the 70s, Dick Wald was the president of NBC News.
Yes, sir.
And he said that he was concerned that you would embarrass him and by extension embarrass the
NBC
division, the
News
network.
True.
Not so much because of something you might do on the air, but you had such a volatile way about you in his view in social situations. You might say anything to the press. A guy could come up to you from the New York Times and who knows how you'd pop off. And it was that as much as what was happening in front of that camera that concerned him.
As I said to you last night, I never got my nose broke on television. I never embarrassed my network. I never took down for 7.5 minutes out of pique at a tennis match like Mr. Rather is supposed to have done. I'm not picking on Dan Rather. But what is all this volatility?
I claim the volatility was a creation of the Dan Aykroyd imitation on Saturday Night Live. It was the creation of I made some flip quotes to the press. You bet I did. Yeah, I shot from the hip now and again. Of course I did. That was in the press, okay? Yep. And there was the perception that somehow I just wasn't a member of the club. There's something going on AM radio. I don't know what it is, but it's doing real good.
Now that's a hummer.
We wind the clock ahead to 1989, and in some portions of the country
right now,
people have a double treat. They could be listening to you on the radio
or a double
and
whammy,
watching you on television.
That's
in
correct.
Some parts of the country, your show would air about this.
Sure, we're on the air right now in some markets in the country. Yep.
How do you like doing that?
Well, you know, you do the radio. You do a number of shows on Sunday nights, Bob Costas, Coast to Coast. As I said, lose that Coast to Coast because no good. I love the radio. The radio is immediate. The radio is live. The radio is instant feedback. It's the town meeting of the air for the 1980s. It's, you know, a lot of people say talk radio. All of us together, myself, Larry King, and the thousands of others who answer the phone on radio around this country, that we turned, all of us together, the congressional pay raise around by telling our listeners, hey, you have to write your congressman. You have to call them and say that this 50% pay raise is nonsense. And that happened. That was turned around. And a lot of people say it was because of radio people exhorting listeners, you can do this.
Do you worry that your appeal is somehow compromised on the radio because you don't have the physical presence to rely on? I know that a lot of the listeners picture you, no question. The people who are with you on the Tomorrow Show, they picture you and the gestures, and they can see your arms flying through the air. But I would think that a lot of the younger listeners have no real sense of who Tom Snyder is.
That's okay. That's okay. I mean, what was on the Tomorrow Show was, and what is on the radio is. People call and they say, you know, I watched you and I think you mellowed. How could I not mellow? How could you not, as you mature, see things in a bit of a different perspective? I mean, good God, when I started the Tomorrow Show, I perceived myself as being a firebrand, a crusading journalist or interviewer or whatever you want to call it. After you talk to the Haldemans and the Ehrlichmans and the Segrettis and the Agnews and all the people in Watergate, I realized I can't sit in judgment of anybody. I can't judge a man or a woman's action based upon the President of the United States saying, hey, you, do this. I can't make situation ethic judgments on that. So, of course, I've mellowed, pulled back, matured. Call it what you will.
If you had Nixon on during Watergate, and he was the only major figure that you did not have on the Tomorrow Show, what do you think your first question out of the box would have been?
Mr. President, I play golf as an avocation. If I were playing a tournament against Jack Nicklaus, he would no more come to my locker and fix my clubs than he would jump off the top of a high building. That's the chance I had of beating him. Mr. President, the Democrats in 1972 had zilch chance of beating you. Why would you snoop on their headquarters? How could you be so stupid? That would have been my question.
On the radio, some of the calls are poignant, aren't they?
Yeah, they really are. There's a lady who listens to us. We were on ABC's 2020 a couple weeks back, month back. Mary Lou, who calls from the Yucca Valley of California, who doesn't even have a phone in her house. She drives the highway late at night to a pay station to call up if she hears a guest that catches her ear or hears an idea that catches her eye. So they shot her out in the cold of the California desert in the middle of the night talking to somebody on the radio. It's really quite something, the people that call up on that show. You're out in the country here tonight, aren't you, Mary Lou?
Yeah.
You're outside to the phone.
Call in tonight, but
he is filling a void that has been in my life the last few months. I'm in the middle of a divorce. A lot of times I'm lonely in the evening. I don't have that much money to go out and go out and do whatever single people do. He's like a big brother and a friend.
We've reached almost the end. Did it feel okay to be back on TV in this time
slot? I love this time slot, and as I said to the people at ABC 2020, you have an audience, young man, that is fiercely loyal, and they will love you to the death as long as you don't con them. They will never forget you as long as you don't let them down. This is the late night audience is the greatest television and radio audience in the world, and there's something about these people that is different from the people of the day as day is from night. They're great, great people you have here, and don't you let them down.
We'll be back.
I'm Tom Snyder, and you've been on the radio show now in Los Angeles, California. Sweet dreams. And sleep tight, America. Good night, everybody.
I guess for now, the appropriate line is Charles Osgood's. See you on the radio.
Thank you.
I enjoyed it very much.
Me too. Thank you, Bob.
Tom Snyder, and we'll see you later.
Bob's guest Monday will be a real star, Shirley MacLaine. Accommodations furnished by the Sheraton Universal Hotel, the official hotel of Universal Studios. On your next visit to Hollywood, visit Sheraton Universal Hotel, the home of the stars.